Brothers and sisters, I also welcome you this evening. The third lesson that was listed was Keys to Understand Scriptures. I decided to move that one tonight to be the first lesson, and then the other four will be in the order as they were listed. I begin by sharing with you an experience that I had many years ago as a young graduate student. Had a class on Isaiah from a brother, Keith Masurvey. And as he went through Isaiah, it was apparent that he had great knowledge of the Isaiah text as he explained the verses and gave his commentary to help us. At one point, after several lessons, another one of the seminary teachers who was in the class raised his hand and he said, "Brother Masurvey, I was just wondering if you could give us maybe a quick, easy way to learn what you understand about Isaiah." And Brother Masurvey was very kind. As he looked at him, he said, "No, my dear brother." He said, "The only thing I know is effort and study. The keys I'll show you this evening are helpful, but every one of them will require effort. So on that basis, we'll proceed. I'd like to begin by showing two scriptures by way of introduction that teach the importance of the scriptures. The first one is in the book of Romans. I always liked what Elder McConkie said about the book of Romans. He said, when you start into the book of Romans, you move into your post-doctoral work in theology. I have decided after studying Romans that Isaiah, the book of Revelation are easy compared to the book of Romans. This is a very difficult book. But I'm going to look at just one verse, chapter 15, verse 4, which is not, by the way, a difficult verse. The Apostle Paul said this, "For whatsoever things were written aforetime were written for our learning, that we, through patience and comfort of the Scriptures, might have hope." Paul then lists one of the purposes of Scriptures, our learning, to teach us and to help us. I want to look at another reference by Paul. This one is in 2 Timothy, and it's in chapter 3, verse 16 and 17. He says, "And that from a child thou hast known the Holy Scriptures." That's high praise for Timothy by Paul, that as a young boy he was a student of the Scriptures, "which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith which is in Christ Jesus." He says, all Scriptures given by inspiration of God, and then he lists the significance and the importance of Scripture. Here they are. First, he says it's profitable for doctrine. Occasion, he said, "He who reads it oftenest will like it best." I have come to know that that statement's true. That comes out of the teachings of Joseph Smith, and it's found on page 56. Now, the first, starting now with the keys to understand Scriptures, the first one I've listed is that Scriptures explain Scriptures. Often, if you use the footnotes, they will help you to unlock other Scriptures. However, the first example I'm going to give you, the footnotes won't help you. And so you'd probably be wise to take notes on this and later mark your scriptures. I selected some from the Old Testament, mostly from the Old Testament. And the reason I did that is because the Old Testament seems to be so hard for members of the church. So I'm going to start in Joshua chapter 6, verse 18 and 19. The historical setting for this chapter is that Joshua, along with the house of Israel, has crossed the Jordan River. They've now entered into the promised land. They're in the Jordan Valley and a fertile place. Even today, it's fertile there. And they face Jericho, a fortress city, a large fortress city. They had to take it. They couldn't leave it at their back and proceed on. So they have to take it. I'm sure by being in primary and Sunday school, you know of the march around the city and how it falls. But my interest tonight is with verse 18 and verse 19. This is instructions from the president of the Church of Jesus Christ, Joshua. He said, "And ye, Israel, in any wise, keep yourselves from the accursed thing. Now, what's the accursed thing? It's anything God tells you not to do, and then you go ahead and do it. Lest ye, Israel, make yourselves accursed. When you take the accursed thing and make the camp of Israel a curse and trouble it, not only do you bring problems upon yourself, but you will upon the entire house of Israel. Here it is. Here's the instructions. But all the silver and gold and vessels of brass and iron are consecrated unto the Lord. They shall come into the treasury of the Lord. They cannot keep anything. Okay, coming back then to verse 19, used wisely by him. Jericho falls, they take Jericho, and in process they did not lose one man. Now come to chapter 7, verse 1. But the children of Israel committed a trespass in the accursed thing, which was chapter 6, verse 18 and 19. For Achan, the son of Carmi, the son of Zabdi, the son of Zerah of the tribe of Judah, took of the accursed thing, and the anger of the Lord was kindled against the children of Israel. Joshua sent men from Jericho to Ai, which is beside Beth-Aven, on the east side of Beth-El, and spake unto them, saying, go up and view the country. And the men went up and viewed Ai. If you were at Jericho down on the plain, and you looked to the north and to the east, several miles up on the ridge, is where Ai is located in Bethel. Bethel, a very sacred place. They returned to Joshua and said unto him, let not all the people go up, but let about 2,000 or 3,000 men. Okay, this one's a small city. They think they can easily take it. There's no need to send a large army. 3,000 men are sufficient to take the city. Verse 5. And the men of Ai smote of them, Israel, about 36 men. They chased the 3,000 in process, killing 36. Now let me tell you what 36 men translates to. It translates to fathers, to husbands, to brothers, sons. And so it's impacted a lot of people in the house of Israel, the killing of those 36 men. Joshua is almost beside himself. He can't understand why a small place like Ai can kill 36 Israelite men. He asks of the Lord what had happened, and the Lord tells him that there is one among the camp who has stole. Starting in verse 16, the Lord begins to identify by tribe who it is. You cannot deceive a prophet of God. It cannot be done. In verse 19 it says, and Joshua said unto Achan, here's our thief, my son, give, I pray thee, glory to the Lord God of Israel. Make confession unto him. Tell me now what thou hast done. Hide it not from me. He confesses in 21 that he stole a Babylonian garment, 200 shekels of silver, and a wedge of gold of 50 shekels weight. In other words, he's taken quite a bit of wealth out of Jericho. He's hid it in his tent. Come down now to verse 24. We now know who the thief is. It's Achan. And Joshua and all Israel with him took Achan, the son of Zerah, the silver and the garment, the wedge of gold, and his sons and his daughters, and his oxen and his asses and his sheep and his tent, and all that he had, they brought them unto the valley of Achor. And Joshua said, why hast thou troubled us? The Lord shall trouble thee this day. And all Israel stoned him, Achan, with stones, and burned them, his children, with fire, after they had stoned them with stones. Now here is where we come to the problem. I just highlighted verses for you, but if you read that whole chapter, there's only one man who did the stealing, that's Achan. But when it come time to punish, Joshua killed the whole family. Bible scholars say that that was wisdom on his part to do that, because if he didn't, the children might eventually seek vengeance and would kill Joshua and those involved in the stoning. However, you and I would have troubles with that, because this is a president of the church who does not kill innocent people. So let's see how Scripture explains Scripture. And we'll go to Joshua chapter 1. And down to verse 8. The Savior, speaking to Joshua, gives him these instructions. This book of the law, the book of the law is Deuteronomy. It means the law. Shalt not depart out of thy mouth. In other words, he is to continually teach the law. He's to teach what's in Deuteronomy. Now, you cannot teach what you do not understand. But thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that's written therein. Note the instructions. He's to teach the law, but to be able to do so, he must study it, and he has to meditate upon it day and night. It's interesting, in the Scriptures, the Savior says we are to feast and to ponder and to meditate. He does not directly say just to read. Usually we're the ones that do that. Now, with that in mind, let's see what the law is. And we're going to go to Deuteronomy chapter 24. Here is the law which Joshua would have known and he would have understood. Joshua 24, verse 16. The fathers shall not be put to death for the children, neither shall the children be put to death for the fathers. Every man. Someone took it out. Makes no difference. Deuteronomy 24, verse 16 unlocks that difficult chapter as to why Joshua killed not only Achan, but all of his children. Because they were involved in the cover-up with their own father. Now, a second one. Let's go to the book of Numbers. Almost everybody's familiar with the story of Tom. When you start in chapter 25, it's a story of immorality. Moabite and Midianite girls seduce Israelite boys and get them to commit sexual transgressions. Let's go, I'll come back to that in a minute, but let's go over to chapter 31. A war, a battle now ensues between Israel and between the Moabites and the Midianites. And in this battle, note in verse 8, and they slew, Israel slew, the kings of Midian, beside the rest of them that were slain, namely Eba, Rakim, Zur, Hur, Reba, five kings of Midian, Balaam also, the son of Beor, they slew with the sword. And now we become confused. How is it that one of the great prophets, who gave one of the great messianic prophecies, stayed faithful to what God instructed him to do? At the end of chapter 24, he's gone home, but in chapter 31, he's killed in the battle, but he's killed on the side of the Moabite and the Midianite. Israel kills him. The answer to the problem is found in the book of Revelation, chapter 2. And thank goodness that John was inspired by the Holy Ghost to include this, or we'd never been able to understand what happened. Now it's relatively easy. So Revelation chapter 2, verse 14. The Savior, speaking to John, says, but I have a few things against thee, because thou hast there them that hold the doctrine of Balaam. Okay, here's the doctrine who taught Balak, remember, king of the Moabites, to cast a stumbling block before the children of Israel, to do two things. One, to eat things sacrificed unto idols. And two, to commit fornication. Now we know what's happened. Only a prophet of God would have known the seriousness of that. Balak would have never known. His worship includes idolatry, includes immorality as part of the worship. Balaam has returned to Balak and told him how he can destroy Israel. He says their own God will destroy them. You won't have to lift a finger if you do the following. Have your prettiest young ladies dressed in their finest clothes. Get them to come up to your idols and to worship there and to commit immoral acts with them, and their God will destroy them. Come back now to chapter 24 and 25. I would make this note in the white space after verse 25 and chapter 25. This is the note I wrote. Revelation chapter 2, verse 14 completes the transition between these two chapters. Now we know what happened. Balaam is the one who corrupted the house of Israel. Elder McConkie calls him the mad prophet. He sold his soul for money and for power and taught one of the most evil things you can read of in the Old Testament. No wonder he's killed fighting on the wrong side. Let's go now to Matthew chapter 22, to the parable of the marriage of the king's son. Matthew chapter 22. And I'm just going to do verse 14. I don't have interest tonight to try and explain the entire parable to you. But verse 14. And when the king came in to see the guests, he saw there a man which had not on a wedding garment. He saith unto him, Friend, friend means member of the church, how camest thou in hither, not having a wedding garment? He was speechless. No, there'll be no excuses in that great day. Now let's go to the book of Revelation to chapter 19, which will unlock those two verses. Revelation 19, and this is verse 7 and 8. He says, let us be glad and rejoice. Give honor to him, for the marriage of the Lamb is come. That's reference to the millennium. His wife hath made herself ready. To her was granted that she should be arrayed in fine linen, clean and white. For the fine linen is the righteousness of the saints. That's how the Savior detected him, not because he had the wrong color of robe on, but by his countenance. His entire countenance showed that he should not have been there. So by verse 11 and verse 12, not 14, Matthew 22, verse 11 and 12, out to the side of that, I would write Revelation 19, verse 7 and 8, which then unlocks how it is the Savior detected him so quickly. Now, one more, and then we'll move to something else. Let's go now to 1 Corinthians, to chapter 10, 1 Corinthians 10. And this is verse 13. This is a common used verse by the members of our church. Paul says, there hath no temptation taken you, but such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that ye are able, but will with the temptation also make a way to escape, that ye may be able to bear it. How often I've heard that quoted in Sunday school and other places, that Satan cannot tempt us past our means to resist. The Book of Mormon clarifies that. And let's go to Alma chapter 13. And this is verse 28, Alma 13, 28. He says, But that ye would humble yourselves before the Lord, call on his holy name, and watch. Watch means pay attention. Pray continually now, that ye may not be tempted above that which ye can bear. You see the significant addition to the teachings of Paul? Therefore, I would make sure that I noted that reference over by 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13, so that you are aware that there's more to it than simply the statement that Satan can't tempt you past your means to resist. It requires humility. It requires diligent prayer, and that you must watch and pay attention. Surely, as a member of the church, we're wise enough to know there's some things we just shouldn't be doing. And we have to be very, very careful. Okay, there's a few examples of Scripture explains Scripture. And brothers and sisters, there's hundreds of them that do that. Generally, the footnotes will lead you to it, but not always. I have found that as you read the Scriptures over and over, that often when you get in a difficult passage, and as you read it and ponder, you think, you know, I have read something about that someplace else. Then you have to start to hunt and to search. And I realize that probably isn't fun, but it is profitable. If you'll keep at it, you'll find the answer to it. Okay, the second one I listed as a key, and this one is more difficult, is a knowledge of history. You must have a knowledge of history to understand some passages. Let's start in the book of Exodus, chapter 1. This brings us to the time period of Joseph and the end of his life in the introduction of the great prophet Moses. There's a difficult passage here that's easily skipped over. It's Exodus chapter 1, it's verse 8 through 11. In verse 8 we read, "Now there arose up a new king over Egypt, which knew not Joseph." I want you to know that that is impossible. And I mean that as literal as I said that. They put the entire record of those pharaohs on those obelisks. They also had a huge library where they kept their scrolls and their records. There's no way a pharaoh can come to the throne that does not know Joseph. "He said unto his people, Behold, the people of the children of Israel are more and mightier than we. Come on, let us deal wisely with them, lest they multiply and it come to pass that when there falleth out any war, they join also unto our enemies and fight against us, and so get them up out of the land." And so they put the Hebrew nation, eventually it'll be covenant Israel, they put them in bondage. Now, by knowledge of history, watch how easy this all becomes. We read the following. "Prior to the advent of Joseph into Egypt, and later his father and brothers, the Hyksos, a Semitic race, had driven out the native pharaohs and conquered Egypt. One historian has written, suddenly as a bolt from the blue, warriors and chariots," and by the way, that's how they conquered Egypt. They had invented the chariot, a weapon that Egypt had never seen. "Drove into the country like arrows shot from a bow, endless columns of them and clouds of dust, day and night, horses' hooves thundered past the frontier posts, rang through city streets, temple squares, the majestic courts of Pharaoh's palaces. Even before the Egyptians realized it had happened, their country was taken by surprise, overrun, and vanquished. Manetho, the great Egyptian historian, testified, we had a king called Thutmose. In his reign it happened. I do not know why God was displeased with us. Unexpectedly from the regions of the east came men of unknown race. Confident of victory, they marched against our land. By force they took it easily without a single battle." The hated Hyksos now reigned for a little over 250 years. In the days of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and Joseph. Sometime after the demise of Joseph, the native pharaohs come back into power and they drove out the hated Hyksos. The verse would better read this way in 8. "Now there arose up a new king over Egypt, which would not acknowledge Joseph or the hated Hyksos as ever having claimed to the throne." Now it makes sense. It also makes sense why they put another Semitic race in bondage, and that is the Hebrews, because they were afraid that they would become powerful and bring the Hyksos back, and they'd be put in bondage again. Thus, we now pick up Moses in the time of the native pharaohs. And by the way, the show of the Ten Commandments, I've seen it several times, wonderful show. There's nothing in it that's true, however, other than there was a man named Moses. That is true. But Moses never stood in a position to be the Pharaoh, and I mean never. Let's go to Matthew chapter 2 in the New Testament, another example of how history helps us. This passage is not difficult, but becomes at least a little more interesting by a knowledge of history. It's Matthew chapter 2, verse 3. Remember, the wise men have come from the east, and they don't know where the king of the Jews is at. They know he's been born. They've seen the star. So they approach Herod to ask him, which, my goodness, of all the people to ask a question like that. Verse 3, when Herod the king had heard these things, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. I note the following about Herod. The Roman Senate appointed him king of Judah in 40 B.C., but it's not till 37 B.C. that he finally is able to get rid of the Hasmonean dynasty. When he did capture Jerusalem, he massacred the entire Sanhedrin except for two persons. He was suspicious, he was cruel, he was selfish and implacable, which means he was not forgiving. He'd never forgive anybody. His victims included his favorite wife, Miriam. As they would get down the street, she was beautiful, so men would look at her. Pretty soon he began to imagine she was having affairs with all these men, and so he had her strangled and killed. He killed her brother, Aristobulus, her grandfather, Hyrcanus. He killed three of his sons. Two of them, he had his guards drowned him, and the other one he put in prison and he starved him to death. Josephus, Flavius Josephus, relates that Herod did not permit the people to meet together, walk together, or eat together. He watched everything that they did. He often would dress, disguise himself as a private citizen. He'd wander the streets of Jerusalem at night to see what they were plotting and what they were doing. You never knew where he was at. His whole career is stained with blood. He's the one, remember, that kills the innocents. Now, with that in mind, look at the verse again. When Herod the king had heard these things, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. He's troubled for one reason, but the people are troubled for another. If you lived in that day and you learned that Herod's upset, you'd probably be panicked, wondering, what is that madman going to do? Well, it didn't take long to find out when he orders the killing of those 2 years old on down. Let's go now to 2 Thessalonians to chapter 2. And my interest is with verse 3. This is a prophecy made by Paul. He says, "Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day, the second coming, shall not come until two things happen. One, except there come a falling away first." That's the great apostasy. "And two, the man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition." Now the question, because that is prophetic, is when was the man of sin, Satan, revealed to the church so that they would know how to deal with him? The answer is at the June 3rd, 1831 General Conference of the Church. Remember, the missionaries called to go to the border of the Lamanites, and Oliver Cowdery in charge of the mission, first come into Mentor, Ohio, into Kirkland. In a little less than 2 weeks, they baptized 120 people into the church. Then they continued on. They left Lyman White in charge. He's a novelist, and he does not understand. Strange things begin to happen in this newly formed branch with these novelists who are now members of the church. Men like Burr Riggs, Edison Fuller, Heman Bassett, they're young men, about 20 years old, began to do strange things. This Heman Bassett, he would get up on a wooden barrel and he would act like a baboon. scratch his sides and make noises like a baboon. Then he'd tell his visions. Edison Fuller would fall and turn black in his face and tell his visions. Burr Riggs, which perhaps he was the worst, he'd grab the joist that goes across with a crossbeam with his hands and pull himself hard and hit his head and knock himself out. When he'd come to, then he would report on the glorious visions he'd just received. All of those things are happening when the prophet Joseph Smith finally arrives on the Western Reserve. At the June 3rd, 1831 conference, the conference is opened with song and prayer. Hundreds of people have gathered. It's a smaller building used for a school. It's owned by Isaac Morley. The building itself is full of individuals. They are gathered around the open door, and there's a couple of windows that was around where they could see what they could and at least be able to hear. After prayer took place, Harvey Whitlock, who's a new convert, began to turn black. At least to the human eye, he appeared to be turning black. His fingernails began to grow long like a mountain lion or like a panther. His eyes took the form of large oval ovals. Hiram Smith turned to his brother and he said, "That is not from God." Joseph Smith had already inquired and he said, "You are correct." He said, "Satan has entered the conference." He then turned to John Murdoch, and he told him to rebuke the devil from Harvey Whitlock, who went into the body of Lyman Copley. Now, he was over 300 pounds. He's the only shaking Quaker I know of that we baptized. He's sitting in the open window on the window ledge. Satan hurled him through the air. He turned a somersault, and he crashed onto a plank that the brethren had been sitting on, but boy, they moved in a hurry. They then rebuke the evil one out of Lyman Copley, who binds Harvey Green and throws him on the floor in convulsions. Finally, Joseph Smith steps forward on the conference floor, and he commanded Satan to leave the building. Zebedee Coltrane, who will become a general authority on February 28, 1835, will be called into the First Quorum of 70, along with Levi Hancock, who also will become a general authority. Zebedee Coltrane said, "Satan went through the open doorway, which was plugged with people, and he cut a swath 10 feet wide, knocking them to the ground." Now, I don't know how he does that, and I have little interest in finding out how he does that. The prophet then said, "Brethren and sisters, that is a beginning to the fulfillment of the prophecy of Paul, that the man of sin would be revealed." Now, in your lifetime, have you ever seen a priesthood leader jump on the pulpit and act like a wild baboon? Have you ever seen, and they was doing this too, have you ever seen at the Elders' Quorum supper someone fall on the cultural hall floor and slither across the floor like a snake? If Satan tried that nonsense with us today, we would catch him instantly. And so the prophet begins to reveal the type of being that he is. And from time to time, even to President Nelson, we have been warned of the power of the evil one and the things that he does. We've been warned about movies and pornography, and on it goes. The man of sin has been revealed to the church. Why? In preparation for the second coming. You cannot win a battle if you do not understand the enemy. Now, the third key that I listed is, I just put critical analysis. And probably an easier word for that is logic and common sense. If you sit and think about the scriptures for a while, generally it'll come to you and you can understand them. Let me show you a couple of examples of that. In 2 Samuel chapter 12, this one deals with David and his immorality with Bathsheba, which has to be one of the saddest stories that's ever been recorded, what happened to this man. 2 Samuel 12, starting with verse 18. Nathan the prophet tells him of the punishments that will come upon him. Here's one of them. "Howbeit, because by this deed thou hast given great occasion to the enemies of the Lord, To blaspheme the child also that is born unto thee shall surely die. Verse 18, and it came to pass on the seventh day that the child died. Now you read that and you think to yourselves, why would God punish the child? Why does the child die? It's not involved in the immorality. Well, with a little thought for just a moment, it's not difficult. What happens to the child? It goes into the paradise and eventually to the celestial kingdom. We know that from Latter-day Revelation. There ain't any problem with the child. So who got punished? Bathsheba did, and David did. Can you imagine the tears that Bathsheba must have shed over the death of that baby and the impact that it had on her, particularly her more so, I think, than even David? There is no sadness with the death of the child. The child will go back into the celestial kingdom from where it came. Let's go over now to John chapter 18. When we turn here, we come to the last night of the incarnate God's life, Jesus the Christ. He has gone to Gethsemane to pray. As he finishes the prayer and is leaving the garden, he has to go across the Kidron. The Kidron sits between the Mount of Olivet and between Jerusalem. There he is met by the traitor Judas. So John 18, we'll start with verse 1. When Jesus had spoken these words, he went forth with his disciples over the brook Kidron, where was a garden, into the which he entered and his disciples. Judas also, which betrayed him, knew the place, for Jesus ofttimes resorted thither with his disciples. Judas then, having received a band of men would have been about 600 Roman soldiers. They've come out of the Antonio Fortress, and they've come out Lion's Gate or Stephen's Gate, which sits then on the east side of Jerusalem. An officer from the chief priests and Pharisees cometh thither with lanterns and torches and weapons. Can you imagine what a dark night that had been? Devil-inspired Judas, Roman soldiers who are professional killers, been involved in battles, they know how to torture and to kill. Jesus, therefore, knowing all things that should come upon him, went forth and said unto them, whom seek ye? No, he's not afraid. They answered him, Jesus of Nazareth. Jesus saith unto them, I am he. He point blank tells them. Judas also, which betrayed him, stood with them. Now, in the Synoptic Gospels, it explains his role. He betrayed Christ with a kiss. So they know who he is two ways. One, Judas betrayed him, and two, he's point blank told him, I'm the one you're looking for. As soon then as he had said unto them, I am he, they went backward and fell to the ground. Then asked he them again, whom seek ye? And they said, Jesus of Nazareth. Now here's the key verse. Jesus answered, I have told you that I am he. If therefore ye seek me, let these, the quorum of the 12 apostles, go their way. That is not a polite request. That is a declarative statement. He is telling them, if you want me to go with you, then these go free. He isn't going any place until the 12 disappear. We forget sometimes who he is. He is the Son of the living God who is in absolute control that night, not 600 Roman soldiers or wicked people from the Sanhedrin. Christ's in charge. Is it not logical to you and I that Satan has in mind that night of killing those 11 apostles? You cannot leave them upon the earth. They hold priesthood keys. They will administer ordinance of salvation and gather Israel. They must die also. Jesus knows that, the intent, and puts a stop to it. And it's not until they disappear into the night that he submits to them and goes with them. Let's go to Matthew chapter 5. This reference has caused no end of debate and sometimes even discouragement. And it need not. Matthew 5, verse 48. The Savior said, be ye therefore perfect, even as your Father, which is in heaven, is perfect. Now, brothers and sisters, that commandment to be like the Father was first given in pre-earth life. That's not a new commandment. That's the ultimate of the plan of salvation, to become like Father in heaven. We worked on that for who knows how long in our pre-mortal life. Our mortal probation would be brief. There's no way we can obtain that mortality, but we can learn to control our physical bodies. We can comply with saving ordinances, and we can strive for perfection. After we die and we enter into the paradise, the command will be in effect over there, and we will continue to work on it. And even after we're resurrected, celestial beings, we still have a long ways to go. Let me show you something that used to trouble me, but I now finally understand it. It's in Doctrine and Covenants, section 88. It's verse 28 and 29. The Savior said, "They who are of a celestial spirit shall receive the same body, a celestial body, which was a natural body or a mortal body at one time. Even ye shall receive your bodies. Your glory shall be that glory by which your bodies are quickened." Quickened means resurrected. "Ye who are quickened by a portion of the celestial glory shall then receive of the same even a fullness." That was the verse that bothered me. I did not know what he meant when he said a portion, until one day I saw something that the prophet Joseph Smith said. He said this. He said, even after we're resurrected and are celestial beings, we will be a long time into eternity before we know enough to act like God, let alone do what he does. We are on the road towards perfection. Our Father in heaven will continue to work with us, to love us, to help us, until one day into the eternities we can finally become like him. The fourth one that I listed is Latter-day Prophets, and this is a key one in helping us to understand scriptures. Let me start in Luke chapter 22. Again, this is the last night of the Savior's life. They've taken him before Caiaphas and the Sanhedrin, where they have mistreated him. As they take him out of the judgment hall, he sees Peter. Remember, Peter at this point has denied him three times. In Luke 22, verse 61, we read, "And the Lord turned and looked upon Peter. Peter remembered the word of the Lord, how he had said unto him, Before the cock crow, thou shalt deny me thrice. Peter went out and wept bitterly." We read that as though the Savior is disappointed in Peter, as though he's unhappy with Peter. Here's what a member of the Quorum of the Twelve had to say about it. Note the difference in the perspective of those who are special witnesses. This comes from Richard G. Scott, Conference Report, April 2002, page 27. He said this, "This tender passage, verse 61, also illustrates how very much the Savior loved Peter. Although he was in the midst of an overpowering challenge to his own life, with all the weight of what was to transpire upon his shoulders, yet he turned and looked at Peter. The love of a teacher transmitted to a beloved student, giving courage and enlightenment in time of need." Is that a different approach to that verse than what we normally teach? And that comes from Elder Cook, a special witness who knew the Savior, and just a great insight from him. Let's go to Genesis chapter 28, to another difficult set of verses where the prophet Joseph Smith unlocks them for us. I'm going to start with verse 12 in Genesis 28. The setting for this, remember, is that Jacob, by deceit, has obtained the birthright from Esau, who is angry with him. And so Jacob is having to flee to the north, to the land of Padan Aram, to his mother's relatives. That night he stops at Bethel, verse 12. And he dreamed, and behold, a ladder set up on the earth, and the top of it reached to heaven. Heaven there is the celestial kingdom. Behold, the angels of God ascending and descending on it. Behold, the Lord God, the Lord stood above it and said, I am the Lord God of Abraham, thy father, and the God of Isaac. The land wherein thou liest, thee will I give it unto thy seed. A difficult passage, but here's what Joseph Smith said about that. He said, Paul ascended into the third heavens. He could understand the three principal rounds of Jacob's ladder, the telestial, the terrestrial, the celestial glories or kingdoms. What is it that Jacob is seeing that night? A vision of the degrees of glory. The ladder extends from earth to the celestial kingdom where God stands in his exalted heaven. There's three rungs on the ladder. Angels are going up and angels coming down. Who are the angels going up? They're mortals, now resurrected, being assigned into telestial, terrestrial, and celestial glory. Who are the angels that are coming down? They are ministering resurrected beings who will minister to terrestrial and then to celestial. Because of Joseph Smith, those verses are easy. That comes out of the teachings of Joseph Smith, page 304 and 305. It's also found in the History of the Church, volume 5, page 402. Now, the fifth key to understanding is symbolism. And let's go to the book of Amos, or Amos, in the Old Testament. The book of Amos to chapter 4. Amos is known as the prophet of social justice. He comes from the little village of Tekoa, which sits just not very far from the Herodian in Israel. In chapter 4, we read, Hear this word, ye kine of Bashan, kine or cattle. Bashan is in Syria at that time. Today it's owned by Israel. If you have cattle up there in those hill area, Bashan, the grass grows high, these are fat cattle, really fat. But that isn't where they live. He says they're in the mountain of Samaria. Mountain means capital. The capital of Israel, the northern kingdom, is Samaria, which oppress the poor. These cattle oppress the poor. They crush the needy, which say to their masters, Now we know the gender of the cattle. They're female, they're cows. Masters is masculine or dominant, bring and let us drink. And so these wealthy society ladies that live in Samaria continually are after their husbands for more, more, and more. And where do they have to go get it? By crushing the needy and the poor with taxes and so forth. What is it that this great prophet just said? He said to these wealthy women, do you know what you remind me of? A bunch of old fat cows out on the plains of Bashan. I don't know about you, that'd take courage to tell those wealthy women that you remind them of a bunch of old fat cows. The Lord God has sworn by his holiness that, lo, the day shall come upon you. He will take you away with hooks and your posterity with fish hooks. That literally is fulfilled. Assyria is the one who will finally conquer the northern kingdom. When they did, they would, with their prisoners, they would put a hook or a clamp through your bone, your jawbone right here, or they'd put it through your lip. Then they'd hook a little chain to it. Now, you can imagine if somebody did that to you and had to hold that chain, you'd go wherever they wanted you to go. Ye shall go out at the breaches, every cow. That's what a breechy cow does. Looks like for a hole in the fence, which is before her, and ye shall cast them into the palace, saith the Lord. The day will come when you will look for any kind of a breach in the defenses, the war machine of Assyria, but you won't find one, and they'll cast you back into your wealthy palaces and homes until they conquer Samaria and take you away with hooks in your jaws. And so by symbolism, that which would appear to not be too interesting becomes very interesting. Now another one. Let's go to the book of Revelation, chapter 4, Revelation 4. And let's see, this one is verse 2 and 3. And immediately I was in the Spirit, and behold, a throne was set in heaven, and one sat on the throne. The one who sits on the throne in these verses is God the Father. And he that sat was to look upon like a jasper and a sardine stone. The jasper is blood, a blood red color. The sardine stone is green. And what it means when it says a jasper and a sardine stone, it means that he controls life and death. And there was a rainbow round about the throne in sight like unto an emerald. Emerald is green. So he sees the Father sitting upon a throne with a beautiful green rainbow that goes over him, the symbol of life or the symbol of eternal life. So by understanding the symbolism, we understand the verse. The Father has eternal life. He has power over life. He has power over death. All of that taught in one verse. Now, what does it take to understand symbolism? This one is hard, and I understand that it is. This is the pattern that Elder McConkie gave. He said it takes time, it takes prayer, and it takes gospel scholarship to understand those three things: time, prayer, gospel scholarship. Number 6 that I listed is the Joseph Smith translation, and I brought one tonight to show you so you can see what they're like. They're black, and the bold letters on it says Joseph Smith's New Translation of the Bible. When they did the new scriptures, they put quite a bit of the Joseph Smith translation in them. If it was 8 words or less, they would put it in the footnotes. If it was 8 words or more, it was put in the back. But even so, they couldn't begin to get all of it. And so you just about have to go buy one. And I don't know if they're available around. You go on Amazon and find them. You get them from the Herald Publishing Company, the Community of Christ in Independence. And they're worth owning. But make sure if you buy one, that you buy this one. Don't buy the inspired version. The inspired version is running text, and you won't be able to use it very easily. This one you can, because it shows parallel columns, the King James and then the inspired translation. So this is the one you want. Now, let me give you an example of it. And this one is footnoted in the scriptures, but this is Revelation 5, and it's verse 6. And watch what the prophet has done to help us here. And I, John, the revelator, beheld, and lo, in the midst of the throne and of the four beasts, and in the midst of the elders stood a lamb. Whenever you see lamb, it has reference to the atonement. As it had been slain, having, here comes the correction, 12 horns, 12 eyes, which are the 12 spirits of God sent forth into all the earth. Now we can understand it. The horn is the symbol of power. 12 represents the quorum of the 12. This is how the Lamb will govern in the earth with power and authority through the 12 apostles. And 12 eyes, they will be filled with light and truth and inspiration, which are the 12 spirits, or we would say servants. And what's their assignment? Why, they are sent forth by God into all the earth. Note then what the JST just did for us, how it's made the verse so much easier. Plus, now it makes sense and you can understand it. The last one that I listed, number 7, let's go to the Pearl of Great Price, to Moses chapter 6. And this one to me is a very key that you want to make sure that you spend some time with this one. So Moses 6, and it's verse 63. This is the great antediluvian seer Enoch who testifies. He said this: Behold, all things have their likeness, and all things are created and made to bear record of me. Note that. All things point to Christ. All things, the heavens, the prophets, their names, their life, everything points to Christ. That includes the temple. As you sit in the temple and you listen to the plan of salvation being taught and so forth, continually ask yourself, how does it point to Christ? What is it that they're trying to teach me? And things will become easier. Now, I'll give you one example of how it points, all things point to Christ. This is in Exodus, and it's in chapter 17. Exodus 17. This is the story in this chapter of Moses, who is bringing estimated 3 to 5 million people out of Egypt. And what a great burden rested on this great man. Verse 1, Exodus 17, 1. And all the congregation of the children of Israel journeyed from the wilderness of Sin after their journeyings, according to the commandment of the Lord, and pitched in Rephidim. And there was no water for the people to drink. Now, Rephidim's in the Great Sinai Desert, and I've been there many times. It can get hot enough at sometimes that you can fry an egg on a rock. And at night, it's so cold that even with a heavy coat on, you get cold. That's how drastic the climate is. If they're in the Great Sinai Desert and they've run out of water, how critical is it? We're going to have about 3 to 5 million people dead here in not too many days. Wherefore the people did chide, chide means they complained, with Moses and said, give us water that we may drink. And Moses said unto them, why chide ye with me? Wherefore do ye tempt the Lord? And the people thirsted there for water. And the people murmured against Moses and said, wherefore is this that thou hast brought us up out of Egypt to kill us and our children and our cattle with thirst? Moses cried unto the Lord. Now, you know what cried is. That's when you're desperate. And he has obviously approached Father in heaven in great prayer and is pleading with him, saying, what shall I do unto this people? They be almost ready to stone me. That's how bad it was. The Lord said unto Moses, go on before the people. Now, that's critical, too. Moses always goes before the people. He stands between Israel and God. He represents God, and he's the mouthpiece of God. Take with thee of the elders of Israel, and that's important also, brothers and sisters. The elders of Israel are special witnesses. In Numbers 1 and Numbers 7, it gives the names of the quorum of the 12 apostles. I would assume that's probably who these are, the special witnesses. There is no way you can get 5 million people in an area where they can see this miracle. It worked the same way in that day as it works today. There are special witnesses who know the Savior. They teach and tutor and love and help us that we can be prepared one day to see the Savior in the great millennial reign, and he will no longer hide his face from us. And thy rod, the rod is the symbol of Moses' power and authority, wherewith thou smoltest the river there that he has reference to is the Nile. Take in thine hand, now to take it in your hand means to have control. He it is that has the priesthood keys. He is the one that has the control of the holy priesthood of God. And go, there's the permission, go. Behold, I'll stand before thee there upon the rock in Horeb. Thou shalt smite the rock, and there shall come water out of it, that the people may drink. And Moses did so in the sight of the elders of Israel. Now, generally we teach that as a great miracle that Moses did, which it is. Or we can ask ourselves, how does it point to Christ? And we can see way beyond the symbol what the Savior intended that we should see. Note these references, I'll just give them to you. Deuteronomy 32, verse 4, says that Christ is the rock. That's his name, the rock. Helaman 5, verse 12, states, we must build on that rock. That is the sure foundation. In John chapter 4, verse 10, he told the woman at the well in Samaria that what? I am the living water. Thus, we began to see the symbolism. We have a rock, and out of it comes water that saves Israel temporally. One day, he who is the rock will come with water and save them spiritually. However, there's one more thing that we have to catch. Note, to get the water out of the rock, you have to hit the rock. It has to be struck. It's not until the Savior is struck down, until he works out the infinite atonement with infinite suffering and pain, and satisfied the demands of justice, that his teachings are enforced throughout all of the eternities. Thus, we have seen way beyond the symbol the reality God intended us to see, that all things point to Christ. Now, in summary, let me just share a brief quote with you that comes from President Howard W. Hunter. He said this: not only should we study each day, but there should be a regular time set aside when we can concentrate without interference. It would be ideal if an hour could be spent each day, but if that much cannot be had, a half hour on a regular basis would result in substantial accomplishment. A quarter of an hour is little time, but it is surprising how much enlightenment and knowledge can be acquired in a subject so meaningful. The important thing is to allow nothing else to ever interfere with our study. That comes out of the book, The Teachings of Howard W. Hunter, page 52 and 53, which is a book edited by Clyde Williams. And Clyde Williams is a very faithful, wonderful member of the church that I have known for many years. I hope those keys, brothers and sisters, will be of some help to you in your quest for truth as you study the standard works of the church. And I close in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
President Stevens, thank you for the lecture tonight. I will go ahead and close with a prayer.